for this second talk. We have the pleasure to listen to Alice Cristeto coming from Nantes. And we'll talk about micro-macro discretizations for collisional kinetic equations of Boltzmann PGK type in the diffusive state.
Thank you, Maxime, and thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak in this workshop. So I will present you joint works with Nicolas Fuzet and Mohamed Benoud from Rennes, and with Giacomo Di Marco from the University of Ferrara. First of all, I will present you our problem and objectives. Then a first micro-macro model that we have studied, its discretization. And after that, I will present you some improvements or extensions of our method. Okay. So here we are interested in the numerical simulation of kinetic problems involving a parameter denoted by epsilon and different scales. And so epsilon is, for example, the Knudsen number, which is linked to the frequency of the collision between particles. When epsilon is big, there is no collision, and so the system stays kinetic, and when epsilon tends to zero, it it goes toward an equilibrium, and so we are in what we call fluid regime. And our aim is to develop schemes that are efficient in both regimes, when epsilon is big and when epsilon is small. There are two main strategies for such multiscale problems. The domain decomposition method, when it is possible, you cut your domain into subdomains, and in each subdomain, you use the good scheme, kinetic one or fluid one. Another approach is the asymptotic preserving method, in the sense of a gene or in the sense of a nickel or alien. So it, the idea is that we want to construct a scheme for the kinetic problem that degenerates when epsilon tends to zero to a nice scheme for the fluid corresponding problem, nice in the sense of consistency and without restrictive condition on the time step, for example. Okay. So here, the first problem I will to present is the 1D radiative transport equation in the diffusive scaling. The unknown is the distribution function f depending on time, position, and velocity. It is governed by this equation, with a transport term in the x direction with a factor 1 over epsilon, and a source term corresponding to the BGK collision operator with a factor 1 over epsilon squared. In the framework we are interested in, rho here is the charge density defined by 1/2 of the integral in the velocity direction of f, and m, which usually depends on v, and it's called m for Maxwellian, here is taken equal to 1, but in all the talk, I will keep the notation m so that you will see where it appears, and so you will see how to generalize with a Maxwellian, a real Maxwellian. And we consider periodic conditions in S and initial conditions. And so it is not easy to construct schemes that are efficient when epsilon is order of order 1 and when epsilon tends to 0. And here the corresponding limit equation is the diffusion equation written there. And so our aim is to construct an LP scheme for this model. And as we know that when epsilon tends to zero, a fluid scheme is sufficient, we want something more. We want a scheme which has a cost reduced at the limit. For that, we use a micro-macro decomposition. And in fact, previous works have been done for this model with micro-macro decomposition. For example, in the work of Crouzet and Lemoux, they used the Eulerian method for the micro and for the macro parts. That is, they had a grid in X and in V. And so whatever the value of epsilon, they needed a grid in V, and so the cost was constant with respect to epsilon. So the idea in this work, in our work, is to use particles for the micro part, so that at the limit, we will be able to take a small number of particles and to represent in the good way the micro part with few particles. Okay, so now I will present you the micro-macro model. So the idea is to use a micro-macro decomposition by writing F as the sum of rho m plus a perturbation denoted by G. We introduce the null space of the BGK operator and the orthogonal projection onto this null space, and we denote it by pi. In our framework, pi of a quantity h is nothing else but m times the first moment of h, which is defined by one half of the integral in V of h. When doing the micro-macro decomposition, we assume that the first moment of G is zero, okay, since by definition the first moment of F is rho. And I will not detail this on the talk, but if it's not true at the numerical level, we have to do something to impose it. And we have used an idea of De Gondi, Marco and Pariski to do. So now, if we apply a pi to our radiative transport equation, we obtain a macro equation on rho of fluid type. And if we apply identity minus pi to our radiative transport equation, we obtain a microscopic equation on G. This one, where here we can see a transport part and a source part. And so the radiative transport equation is equivalent to this micro-macro system where I have introduced the notation F for this parenthesis. And we will have a problem with this micro-macro system since we have stiff terms in the equation on G in particular. But I've said that previous work has been done on this micro-macro system. But in this previous work, they had a grid in X and V to represent G, and so they were able to implicit this term. And with that, the term of order 1 over epsilon was automatically stabilized. Okay. But in our case, we want to use a particle for the micro part. And with particle method, we are obliged to split between the transport and the source terms. And so we will not be able to use the same strategy. So we have to do something else. And the idea is to reformulate our micro-macro system. For that, we will use the following strategy. We work on the micro equation, this one. And first of all, we will write it like that, just by multiplying it by exponential t over epsilon 2. Then, we consider two times tn and tn plus 1, and we integrate this equation between tn and tn plus 1. So this term can be integrated exactly, and we obtain these two terms. And we have to integrate the right-hand side. We cannot integrate it exactly since f is not known at each time. So what we propose is to use the left rectangle method for f. So f goes out of the integral, and then we integrate exactly what stays in the integral, this exponential. And after that, we multiply all the expression by this exponential over delta t, and we obtain this expression with an error of order delta t that comes from the rectangle method. In fact, it was an order delta t to the square divided by delta t. And now we say that we recognize here a first order approximation of dtg, and so we approximate this expression by this equation. And we use this equation as our micro equation. And in this one, there is no more stiff tears, and it is consistent with the previous one. So our new micro-macro model is the following one. And for this model, we propose hybrid discretization. We will use a finite volume method for the macro equation on rho and a particle method for the micro equation on G. Now I will present you this discretization. First of all, the big steps of the algorithm. We will begin by solving the equation of G by a particle inside method. After that, we have to numerically force to zero the first moment of G. I will not detail this part, but if you are interested in it, you can look at the paper by the Gondi Marco et al.
Sorry.
And at the end, we have to solve the macro part by a finite volume scheme, so that we will need a mesh in X, only in X.
So this delta t could be anything? Delta t?
The delta t will be the delta t that we will take in our simulation. And in fact, such a coupling between a particle method for a kinetic equation and a Eulerian method for an equilibrium part has similarities with the delta F method that is used by plasma physicists. Okay, so now I will give some details about the particle inside method. The idea is to represent the distribution function for us, it's G, by numerical particles. We will consider here NP numerical particles. Each particle has a position, xk, a velocity, vk, and a weight, omega k. And we say that G is approximated by the sum of Dirac masses centered on the position and the velocity of particles multiplied by the weight. And as Miguel said in his talk, it's possible, and sometimes we have to regularize such a description of G. I will only consider Dirac masses in this talk. But in practice, we regularize it. So, first of all, we have to define how to initialize the particles. What we have chosen to do is to distribute position and velocity of particles uniformly in the phase space, in X and in our domain in X and B. And then weights of the particles are initialized in order to represent the initial distribution function G. That is, initially, the weight of particle k is equal to g at time 0 evaluated on xk dk times this factor, where lx is the length of the domain in the x direction, lv in the v direction. And so this factor means that each particle represents g in a small area around the position xk dk. And now that the particles are initialized, we will evolve them by resolving the equation on G. This equation can be written like that, dtg plus a transport part in the x direction equals a source part, which is detailed here. As I said, we have to do a splitting between the transport and the source part. So first, we will solve the transport part, and as Miguel said in his talk, the classical thing is to translate the equation into motion equation, and so the time derivative of position xk is equal to this factor time vk. And for example, we can take a first order explicit scheme for evolving the position of particle. In our simple case, velocity are constant because there is no transport in the velocity direction. And so after that, we have to solve the source part. I have written it as dtg equal sg, and the idea is to translate this equation into the weights of particles. So the weight of g are omega k. So here I am considering the time derivative of omega k, and I say that it's equal to the weight corresponding to the source term, that is, the source term evaluated in xk vk times the small area that represents each particle. And in fact, if we look at the expression of sg, the source term, we can recognize some part of this expression. So here g has the weight omega k, and now I only have to compute the weight of these two terms that I have denoted by alpha k for this one and beta k for this one. And I use a first order time approximation of omega k. I have only to compute this weight omega k and beta k. And to do that, I evaluate the expression v dx rho m on vk xk, and I multiply by the factor, and I do the same for beta k. And so the equation on g is solved with this particle method. So now I have to look at the equation on rho, at the macro part. The first idea is to use the new expression of g, that is to use g at time n plus 1. Here, if we consider a finite volume method, this moment on the cell I has to be an approximation of 1 over delta x, the integral on the cell I, of the moment of Vg. And if you remember, the moment of Vg was 1 half of the integral in V of Vg. And if we consider that G is approximated by Dirac masses, we recover a sum over all the particles that are in the cell I of Vk, coming from this V, times the weight of the particles. In fact, using this expression at time n plus 1 is not a good idea, because G is represented by particles, and so it suffers from numerical noise. And the factor 1 over epsilon here will amplify this noise when epsilon will tend to 0. And so at the limit, the noise coming from G will damage rho, and in particular, we will lose the asymptotic behavior. So we try to do something else. And for that, in fact, we will look at the weight of Gn plus 1 at time. Okay, the weight of Gn plus 1. How did we compute them? We used exactly this scheme just before. And so the idea here is to separate the term involving G, which is noisy, that is this term and this one, from the terms involving rho, which is not noisy. So I introduce HIN, which is the first moment of V times this term plus V times this term. That's what I have written there. And so the moment VGN plus 1 can be seen as HIN plus the first moment of G times this term. Okay. And this factor, so we recover this factor here. We have the x rho, which is we can go out of the integral in V, and we only have to compute the integral of V times V, and it gives us one result. And now we can we will inject this expression for the first moment of Pgn plus 1 in the macro equation. And so the terms involving G are here, and the term involving rho are here. And what's nice is that we can verify that HIN is of order epsilon squared when epsilon tends to zero, because if we look at the weight, here we see that omega k is of order epsilon, so is G, and so HIN is of order epsilon square. And so, even if HIN is noisy, when the noise is of order epsilon square, and when we will divide it by epsilon, we will have a noise of order epsilon, and so at the limit, it will not affect rho. And the other thing is that we directly see that at the limit epsilon tends to zero, we recover a scheme for the diffusion equation. And we can do something else. We can, in fact, take this term implicit in time. And so we will avoid restrictive condition on the time step of parabolic time. And so we have the following property that I said just before, and especially for fixed delta t, the scheme degenerates into an implicit first order scheme of the diffusion equation. And so we are A. And I said the other things. Yes, and just since G is of order epsilon, when epsilon will be very small, a few particles will be sufficient to represent it. So the cost will be reduced and will be more or less the one of the free part. Okay. Hop. And we can verify these properties, some of them. So here, I plot the density rho as a function of x at time t equal 0.1. Here, the black line here corresponds to the result obtained by free discretization of the diffusion equation. And the other plots correspond to our method for different values of epsilon. When epsilon is big, we have this curve and we are far from the equilibrium, and when epsilon diminishes, we go towards the equilibrium. And we can verify that at the limit, when epsilon is small, here 10 to the minus 6, 100 particles are sufficient to represent in a good way G and the fluid part. Okay. So now I will present you some improvement or extension of our method. We were interested in different extensions. First, we would like to derive a second order in time scheme. And we would like to consider more class map test cases by introducing an electric field and so transport in the velocity direction. And so I will present you these two works, not in detail, but just I will just give you the key points. And in another work, we were interested in multidimensional test cases. And to do that, it seemed important to us to have a scheme in which the number of particles reduces automatically when epsilon is small. Because in the scheme that I've presented to you, in our particle in cell method, we fixed the number of particles at the beginning. If we know that epsilon is small, we take a few particles. If we know that epsilon is big, we take more particles, but we have to fix it. And by using Monte Carlo technique, we will be able to have a scheme which more or less choose the best number of particles depending on epsilon and in the time of the simulation. Okay, so first, how to derive a second order in time scheme. To do that, we have to work on a different part of our method. We have to work on the micro-macro model. We will have to reformulate it. Of course, we have to work on the text scheme. And by doing that, we have to be careful in order to keep the second order at the limit 2. If we have terms that disappear when epsilon tends to 0, and if these terms are important to have the second order, we have lost everything at the limit. Okay, so first we have to work on the micro-macro system. In fact, to obtain our micro equation, we have integrated in time this expression, and we have used the first order formula. If we want to have a chance to be a second order in time, we have to use a second order formula, and for example, the midpoint method for the right-hand side. So we use a midpoint method for the right-hand side, and then we do the same thing. We make a pair a discrete time derivative. And the idea is to say, okay, this is a second order derivative approximation of this time derivative of g at time n plus 1 half. But to do so, we have to have here g at time n plus 1 half. And so we make it a pair by performing Taylor expansion. And this time derivative will go with this one. And finally, we obtain a new micro-macro system. And so now we have to work on the time scheme. Of course, we have to consider a second order scheme. And so we propose to use a prediction correction scheme. For the prediction step, we have done nothing particular. For the correction step, in fact, we can choose at what time we want to take this term. And I have denoted it by g tilde here. And if we want to be second order in time at the limit, we have not so many choices, but for example, this expression of g tilde will work. After that, we can do the same key discretization for the micro equation, and for the macro one, we can do the same tweak by separating the terms involving g from the term involving rho, and we can implicit rho in the conical scheme, for example. And now we have obtained a scheme that is second order in time for fixed epsilon, and that when epsilon tends to zero, degenerates into an implicit second order scheme of the diffusion equation. And we can verify this by plotting the error on rho as a function of delta t for different values of epsilon. And here you have the slope equal to 2 that is plotted. Okay. Now another question. How to consider a problem with an electric field? We have in mind such a problem, Vlasov-BGK equation. So now we have a transport in the velocity direction given by the electric field E, which is governed by the Poisson equation. And in this framework, I've taken the absolute Maxwellian. And in fact, all the computations that we have done works of the same manner. Concerning the limit, it's here the group diffusion limit. And so in fact, including an electric field does not add many difficulties. Of course, we have to change some things. For example, we have to change the definition of F because it has more terms involving the electric field. But after that, we can do the same reformulation of the macro system with this F of first order or of second order. For the macro discretization, the finite volume scheme, we have nothing particular to do. But for the micro discretization, now velocity are no more constant. There is a transport in the velocity direction, and so we have to evolve the velocity of particles. And for example, we use the first order scheme for that. And we have to solve Poisson equation. We can do this by finite differences if we want, for example. And with this, we are able to compute some classical test cases, such as Landau damping. Here, the perturbation G is initially zero. Okay. And we look at the evolution in time of the electrical energy. And so we obtain this kind of figures for big values of epsilon equal 1 there and 0.5 there. So in black there, we have a reference solution given by a scheme which uses micro-macro decomposition and a grid in X and V for both micro and macro parts. These two plots in blue and magenta are obtained by our method, so the particle micro-macro method, of first or second order in time. And here, we have two methods that solve with particles the first Vlasov equation on F. That is, they used particles to represent F and not only to represent G. And since particle methods are noisy, if we represent a quantity like F, which is of order 1, the noise will damage the electric field, and so we will not be able to recover the behavior of the electrical energy when time goes by. Of course, we can improve this simulation by adding more particles, but the cost will be bigger. Okay, we have the same kind of results when epsilon tends to zero. Here it's 0.1 and here 10 to the minus 4. And in these cases, we can compare our method to the to the discretization of the Dwight kinetic equation. So to the limit scheme. We can do the same things for a two-stream instability case where G is not zero initially, and in fact we obtain the same kind of result. So maybe I will just go fast on this part. And in these cases, Landau damping or two-stream instability, if we consider, we find solution as a reference, we can verify that our scheme is of order 2 in time for different values of epsilon. Okay, now I will present you multidimensional test cases. So to do so, we decided to use Monte Carlo techniques. And so if you want some references about this, you can, for example, look at these papers from DiMarco and co-authors. Monte Carlo techniques will help us to have a smaller cost, and so it will be easier to consider two or three dimensional test cases. We are interested in this test case, so without electric field, or without electromagnetic field, and no transport in the velocity direction. And we would like to construct an asymptotic preserving scheme for this asymptotic diffusion equation. The key point is to consider a discretization of G by particles, but with a number of particles that depends on time. So here, the number of particles depends on time, and the weight of particles are constant. Okay. I will not give the details, but if we know if we have an expression for a distribution function, we are able to sample particles that correspond to this distribution function. So, for example, initially, we are able to sample particles that will represent G at time zero in a good way. Now that we have initialized our particles, we solve the transport part of the microequation as previously with motion equation. And for the source part, we will use the Monte Carlo strategy. So the source part is of the equation on G is written there. G tilde is only G after the transport part. So the position of particles are moved. That's it. The Monte Carlo strategy consists in saying that with a probability exponential minus delta t over epsilon square, the distribution function does not change. Okay. And with probability 1 minus exponential minus delta t over epsilon square, the distribution function is replaced by this new one. And in practice, how do we do that? So first, we will do that cell by cell. Thanks to our macro equation, we have a cell in X. Okay? We will use this mesh in X, and we will do the Monte Carlo technique cell by cell. And so in each cell, we will keep a number of particles that correspond to this probability, exponential minus delta t over epsilon square. These particles are kept unchanged, okay, and we delete all the other particles. And after that, we create new particles in order to consider that the distribution function is replaced by this new distribution function with this probability. And for that, we sample new particles in our cell. And in fact, if we were able to do that initially, we are able to do that knowing this expression, or knowing an approximation of this expression, discretization of this expression. Okay. Okay, and so we have checked this method in 2D, 2D cases and in 3D, 3D cases. And I will just show you some numerical results. First of all, we can look at the time evolution of the number of particles in our system for different values of epsilon. Here, we had initially a case that, like a Landau damping case, that is G was zero initially. Okay, so G is zero initially. Then, the system creates particles in order to take into account the kinetic effect of our system. So, particles are created. For epsilon is big here, for epsilon smaller in the other curves. And after a moment, the system begins to reach an equilibrium, and so G becomes smaller, and so the number of particles automatically diminish in our system, whatever the value of epsilon. And so the cost is reduced when time goes by, when we reach the equilibrium. Another nice thing is that now we are able to consider epsilon that are no more constant. For example, epsilon that depend on x, so x and y in our 2D case. So we have considered a slightly different model, that is, in front of the transport part, we have a constant epsilon, and in front of the collision part, we have an epsilon that depends on x, and that has this following form. So in some part of the domain, it's quite big, till 10, and in other part, it's small. And we can look, for example, at the density as a function of x and y at time equals to 1. So here, what we can see is that in some part of the domain, we have reached an equilibrium, and in other parts, we have not reached equilibrium, and the density is bigger than the equilibrium. And we can compare our micro-macro Monte Carlo approach to a micro-macro grid approach that we have considered as a reference. And in fact, what's interesting is that if initially we have particles uniformly distributed in the domain, in x and y, at time t equals 1, all the particles have been cancelled where epsilon is small, and we only have particles where epsilon is big. And to finish, I will present you a full 3D case. So here we look at the integral in the x direction of f, so we see a quantity depending on v, with v which is a 3D. Initially, we have two Maxwellian in 3D, and what we expect is that they will go towards a global equilibrium. And it seems to be okay. And here on the left, we have epsilon equals to 1. On the right, epsilon equals to 0.5. And what we see is that when epsilon is smaller, the equilibrium is reached faster. Okay. So, to conclude, we have presented AP schemes. And it was possible to extend this scheme in a second-order time scheme. The computational cost is reduced when the equilibrium is approached, or when epsilon is small, depending on the particle method we used. From another point of view, compared to a standard particle method on the whole distribution function f without micro-macro decomposition, the numerical noise is smaller. And so we are able to present multi-dimensional test cases. As future works, we would like to consider more relevant test cases, especially in full 3D dimensions. And first, we would like to consider more general collisional operator, for example, Boltzmann operator. And we would like to consider an electromagnetic field in the last method that I've presented to you with the Monte Carlo strategy. I thank you for your attention.
Any questions?
In the 1D problem that you studied, so you show some numerical simulations to show that when epsilon becomes smaller, your number of particles can be small. So in your analysis, do you get some kind of quantitative estimates relating epsilon and the NP?
No.
Number of particles?
No. So it was what we know is that G is of order epsilon, and so we expect that the number of particles is a constant time epsilon, but we have not checked this exactly.
And this method, does it work only for diffusive scaling? Can you do other scaling?
In fact, we have done such a method for the aerodynamic case.
And it fits the...
Yes.
It's AP.
Yes. So it was only the first order scheme in time. Yes, it was AP. And what we have done, so it was a first work with Nicolas and Giacomo. Nicolas and Morel, sorry. And... in fact, we were able to consider more moments on the equation, and so to have a Euler equation for the limit.
And for example, this last example you showed, epsilon x being a function.
Yes.
Can you have compressible limits in one region and incompressible in another?
For me, the problem here is to write a model maybe the first model. Because here we have to pay attention if we want to have an epsilon depending on x. Because the right things would be to put the 1 over epsilon in the x derivative, and so we will have some derivative of epsilon. We can try to write such a model, but I'm not sure that numerically it will be easy to work with. But maybe.
Other questions? In the hydrodynamic scaling, you did it with a nonlinear BGK model or with this method?
No, it was a BGK.
The full, so that you did all three equations at the limit. Okay, so thank you again, Alice.